at the end of class. At the end of class.
Okay.
There you go.
There you go. Came out for the
class. Use this class.
I actually use a lot of the 90s class.
Okay.
Yeah. So.
For what?
Yeah, through the property.
The one you got?
Yeah, no, that's for work.
Oh, okay.
So I got a meeting with my Sony and then what I was able to negotiate is guys, you know, I can be in and out of this, you know, property, you know, it's going to be a huge thing.
Oh,
yeah,
sure
about
that.
That's why the code is recording and then back and forth. And then I don't know how a guy gave me a clue that it's this is the feature of what the property. This is the feature that we're kind of anticipating for this area. I said, well, if that's the feature, why don't we set up an easement for the potential buyer of this property instead of just for us? Because for us, it's clear that it doesn't apply. And then they both look at each other and like, well, you know, we can't get this guy to give us the easements. But you know, maybe in the future we can get the easement. So they were like, well, we haven't done that before. And I said, look, this is, I don't give you the easement right now, but if we're purchasing the property in the future, we'll get the easement.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, you guys are trying to redevelop this area. You guys get what you need and then you don't put it in our business. And then if you think about it, that was here for others to come. That only applies to retail offices, but at least it's industrial. I'm trying to get an industrial.
Uh-huh.
And then they say, okay, let's do it. So
there you go, get some leverage on that.
How is my first negotiation with the city?
So basically they rezoned the parcel
to
commercial.
They gave us the special use that we needed to do the condition, but they also wanted to apply the
easement.
So
they got easement and you got rezoned.
I got this one, that was already...
That was already in place before.
Yeah, but one of the requirements was the easement. So I was able to negotiate that the easement were not going to be enforced to us, just the person who would potentially buy that
in
property.
In the future.
Nice,
okay.
No,
they agreed to that?
I'd like to get started, please. We're going to try to start on time, as we said last time. And we'll break it 1:45, if y'all will remind me, please, so we can take a 15-minute break before the offer dolls close at 2. I want to make one or two more comments again about our midterm. Everybody's completed their makeups now. As I said previously, and hopefully for the benefit of those who weren't here before, there will be no makeups on the final. Be here. There's no time for makeups. On the midterms, the class did extremely well. There were 10 A's. There were no B's. There were 4 C's. And then a couple of. But remarkably, no B's, but 10 A's is just huge. I've never had more than half of the class get A's on a test before. I'm very impressed, and obviously everybody prepared very well and did really well. I will pass out the marked up midterms at the end of class. And for those who continue to not be here at the end of the class, they may never get there back. So we're going to pick back up with chapter 15 that we talked about a little bit. Chapter 15 is deeds. And we had hoped to get through it last time, but we're certainly going to get through it this time. We talked about a bunch of introductory stuff on deeds. To understand that a deed is something signed by the person that conveys your property to you, period. It's not issued by the state. It's not like a motor vehicle certificate. You get your deeds from your closing one time, and that's it. And your deed is as good as the title that was given to you by your seller, or as bad as the title that was given to you by your seller, but that's where your document comes from. And we talked about in general, and most people knew this, that a deed is a legal instrument that conveys title to real estate. That's pretty obvious. It's signed by a grantor only. It's issued in favor of a grantee. That's the seller and the buyer. Grantor being the seller, grantee being the buyer. One of the few times we have to use those terms because they're just part of all deed forms, grantor and grantee, but it's really the person who's given title and the person who's getting title. We're going to talk about the four types of deeds that are in use in Florida, what the differences are. We do things in Florida a little bit differently than the textbook. So frankly, I'd like you to pay a lot more attention to what I have to say about deeds and a lot less to what the text says, because in Florida, it's not that we're necessarily unique or different. It's just, this is how we do it, and this is what you're likely to see. Understanding simply that a deed is the legal instrument that conveys title. The distinction between the types of deeds all boils down to warranties or guarantees. In a deed, to a greater or a lesser extent, the seller, meaning the grantor, guarantees the title. Guarantee is the same as a warranty. The seller warrants the title. So the most common type of deed that we use in Florida is the warranty deed. Now, the text speaks as if there are two types of warranty deeds, and the second one we're going to talk about is a special warranty deed. I don't think of it at all as two types of warranty deed. Just two types of deeds, period. A warranty deed, which is also known as a general warranty deed, it's sometimes known as a full warranty deed, but simply if you say warranty deed, you're speaking of what we describe as the deed that provides full warranties. What's going on in a warranty deed is the seller, the person that signs it, fully warrants the title to the property. That means the seller fully guarantees to the buyer. The title is good. There are no liens. There are no claims. There are no exceptions. There are no matters outstanding. There's nothing wrong with the title. Remember last week we talked about a chapter called involuntary liens, where we had mechanics liens and judgment liens and tax liens. Well, the seller's guaranteeing against all that stuff. That's what the seller warrants.
So it's a clear title.
Clear, good, unencumbered, clean, no outstanding claims title. Now the text talks about the five types of warranties. You don't need to know these. These are old English common law. They're funky things like the covenant of season and the covenant of quiet enjoyment and the covenant of this and the covenant of that. It doesn't matter. In Florida, we have a form for a warranty deed. We'll talk about that in a second. But most importantly, what that form says and what the statute says that created that form is that when the seller in Florida gives a warranty deed, by law, the seller is giving all five of those covenants, all five of those guarantees. You don't need to know what those are. They simply boil down to, exactly like Paul said, good title. Good, clear, marketable, unencumbered title with no liens on it. That's what the seller guarantees in a warranty deed. Now, that sounds lovely. The seller guarantees the title. What could be better than that? Well, a lot of things could be better than that. Not better in terms of a better deed form, but what that does is that gives the buyer the right to sue the seller. saying you gave me bad title. But that seller might have gone to Venezuela, or he might have taken the money from the closing and lost it to the track that afternoon. The seller's warranty is only as good as the financial strength of the seller. And you don't get to bargain for who my seller is. I mean, you pick out a piece of property and the seller is who he is. And that's who you're getting a deed from. And he may have nothing else, or he may have lots of other assets. In which case, if he has lots of other assets, then the warranty from that seller is longer than a warranty from somebody who had nothing else and might have lost the money that afternoon. So the point is, it's nice that the seller warrants the title in a warranty deed. That gives you the right to sue a seller if you later find out the title wasn't good, or you later find out there were some liens on there. But that may be a pretty hollow remedy. How good is it? The guy has nothing, he's blown the money, or understand the money from your closing may have gone to pay off three or four mortgages. And the seller might have gotten 50 cents at the closing. Well, that's how much money the seller may have, is 50 cents, you know? It ain't a great remedy. It's as good as it gets. The best deed you can get gives you rights against the seller, but it doesn't mean the title is good. We're going to talk later in another chapter about, so you examine the title and you make sure that the title is clear, but it's always good to have the seller guarantee it. That's what you get in a warranty deed. Now, in Florida we have a statute, as I mentioned, that says the following is the form of a warranty deed. The point is, if you use the couple of words from the statute, you have therefore created a warranty deed. The terms are simply the two buzzwords that make a warranty deed are, first, that the seller says that he fully warrants the title to the property. Fully warrants. Every warranty deed in Florida says the seller fully warrants the title. And he warrants the title against the claims of all persons whomsoever. Obviously, that's everybody. He's warranting the title, fully warranting the title, against the claims of everybody. That's what a warranty deed does, and that's what the form says. Note this, if you would. Basically, whenever the legislature adopts a form by a statute, or the Secretary of State puts out a form of an LLC's article should look like this, or a corporate's article of incorporation, corporation should look like this, anytime there's a statutory form in Florida, for God's sake, use it. Don't change it. Don't try to outsmart it. The point is, if the legislature says the following form is a warranty deed, why on earth would you do anything else? Or why would you get cute? But the buzzwords, the operative words from that warranty deed form are fully warrant the title, will defend against the claims of all persons whomsoever. Now, second type of deed is a special warranty deed. That's what we call it in Florida. Some states call it a limited warranty deed. Some states call it a restricted warranty deed. In Florida, we call it a special warranty deed. Now, all that really means is it's not a full warranty. It's a special warranty, a limited warranty. And here's what the seller says there. The seller says, I warrant the title, or he may say, I fully warrant the title. But here's what he says. Against all persons claiming by, through, or under me. Here's what that means. When a person fully warrants the title, against the claims of all persons whomsoever. In a full warranty deed, a warranty deed as we call it, that person is warranting the title all the way back to the treaty with Spain. That's where Florida came from. Spain transferred the property to the United States. Then Florida became a state. The United States, by a document called a patent, transferred all the property in Florida to the Florida government. And then one by one, as to every piece of property, the state of Florida gives a deed. In the history of every piece of property you're going to look to, except what's still owned by the state of Florida, you're going to find a deed out of Florida. And before that, you're going to find a patent as to a certain area that was given by the U.S. to Florida. And the history, the furthest back history of that is a treaty with Spain. My point is, when a person gives a full warranty deed, they are warranting the title all the way back in the whole chain. Back 30 years, back 90 years, back 200 years. When Florida became a state. That's a general warranty deed, a full warranty deed. A special warranty deed, the person says, I'm warranting the title against all persons claiming by, through, or under me. What that means is, they're guaranteeing the title for the period of time the seller has owned that property. That might be 1 year, that might be 20 years, it could be 50 years, but that's it. It's a special warranty deed warranting only against claims through that seller. Bear with me 1 second, I just want to make this point. What that means is, that person is saying, there are no liens against me. There are no taxes unpaid for the period of time that I own the property. I didn't put any mortgages on there. Nobody got judgments against me. But they're not saying that there are no judgments against the guy that sold it to them or the guy who sold it to him. They're not guaranteeing the title all the way back. They're guaranteeing the title only for the period of time they own the property. Did that answer your question? I'm sorry.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, think about who would want to give a deed like that and who would want to accept a deed like that. Well, the person who would want to give a special warranty deed and limit his warranties is somebody with a deep pocket. General Motors, or a bank, best of all is a bank. When a bank takes a piece of property back in foreclosure, and then the bank sells the property to an ultimate buyer after a foreclosure, does the bank want to warrant the title to that piece of property all the way back to the Treaty with Spain? Hell no. The bank only wants to warrant it has good title right now, and it hasn't put any mortgages on there. It's not warranting against what the guy that they foreclosed and took the title away from did, or the guy before him, or the person before her. Okay? Banks are the most, GM to me is my great example of the deepest pocket. But realistically, in terms of people you're going to deal with, you're going to probably buy properties from which title came through a foreclosure. And that person who gets title in the foreclosure and then sells really doesn't want to guarantee the title all the way back. He just wants to guarantee he didn't screw it up. He didn't do anything. That's where you're going to get a special warranty deed. That is a seller saying, I warrant the title against anybody claiming, and these are the buzzwords in a special warranty deed, and you'll see them when we look at them in a minute. I warrant the title against anybody claiming by, through, or under, it says, the grantor, which means me, the person signing the deed. Okay, that's a special warranty deed. The third type of deed we have in Florida is not the bargain and sale deed that you see in the text. I don't know what that is. I've never seen one. I've never heard of one. I'll bet you plenty of bucks you're never going to see one. But you are going to see what I call the third type of deed that we use in Florida, and that's a quitclaim deed.
What is that?
Frequently referred to by realtors as a quitclaim deed. That's not what it is. It's a quitclaim deed. And thinking through the terms, and again, I've tried throughout this course to try to help you make sense out of the title of something we talk about. So the light will go on or a bell will ring that says, oh yeah, I understand the title to that instrument. Therefore, I know what it is. Person quits claiming title. That's all it is. quitclaim. There are no warranties whatsoever in a quitclaim deed. The seller says, the signer of the deed, I say seller, the person, the grantor, the person who's signing the deed, simply says, if I have any interest in this property whatsoever, I'm giving it to you. Now, these are frequently used in a divorce situation. One party in a divorce, you know, the judge will decide in the final hearing, okay, wife gets the house. Well, the seller sure as hell not going to warranty the title to the wife so she can sue him when they have bad title. He's going to give a quitclaim deed, or vice versa. Heirs in an estate. Maybe somebody forgot to get deeds from all of the heirs of some guy who had a quarter interest in a piece of property. Well, those heirs don't know anything about the title of that property. They're probably not getting paid for it. Usually when you give a quitclaim deed, you're not getting paid for it. You're just saying, if I have an interest, fine, here it is. You're not guaranteeing you own anything. If you have an interest, it conveys it. If you don't have an interest, it doesn't convey anything. So what that means is simply, I'll be glad to give you a quitclaim deed to her house and give any of you a quitclaim deed to this building. Fine. I don't own it. I'm not warrantying it. You can't sue me if the deed's no good because I didn't guarantee it. I'll give anybody a quitclaim deed to anything. Free. Because if they think they want it, if they want it and they think they need it, what the hell? Give it to them. If you think you don't have any interest in a piece of property anyway and somebody else thinks you do, great. Tell them, sure, I'll sign a quitclaim deed. But you sure as hell wouldn't want to sign a warranty deed. Guarantee the title. You're not getting paid for it. Remember that we didn't focus on this as fully as we should have when we went through the sales contract, because we went through the sales contract fast. But there was a section in the sales contract where the seller checks off what type of deed it's willing to give. In that pre-printed form commercial sales contract in the middle of the second page, it says title will be conveyed by, and you check off the blanks. Warranty deed, special warranty deed, and I think it says other. The point is, if you're a buyer submitting a contract to a seller, well, you're going to check that blank that says warranty deed. You want a warranty deed. If you're a big shot seller like a bank, you're going to change that and say, no, I'll give you a special warranty deed. Parties bargain in a transaction just like they bargain over the closing date and they bargain over the price. They bargain over what type of deed a seller will give. And sometimes deals have gone south over the failure of the parties to be able to agree. Sometimes a big shot seller has said, I'm only giving a special warranty deed. And sometimes an equally strong buyer has said, hell no, you give me a full warranty deed or I'm not buying the property. And deals have died over that. It is an issue to be negotiated between buyer and seller. What's the seller willing to give? What's the buyer willing to accept? Those are the three types of deeds we use in Florida. There is a fourth type that I want you to be familiar with that we also use, but it comes up under a uniquely certain situation only, which we'll talk about and you'll see why, and that's called a fiduciary deed. You remember we talked about a fiduciary. A fiduciary is a person that operates in a position of trust, looking out for somebody else in a position of trust, like a trustee, like a personal representative of an estate, like the guardian of an incompetent or the guardian of an underage person, of a minor. A person who serves in a position of trust called a fiduciary capacity for the benefit of somebody else will only give a fiduciary deed. And here's why. And here's what the fiduciary is saying. The fiduciary is saying, I guarantee to you that I have the authority to sign this deed on behalf of whoever I'm acting for. In other words, a trust. The trustee is saying, I guarantee that I have the authority to sign this deed under the terms of the trust. but I'm not guaranteeing the title at all. What does that trustee know about how good his title is? He doesn't know. Or how, what does he know about the incompetent person's title? He doesn't know. And it's usually a bank, or a lawyer, or an accountant, or a bank trust officer. They don't know whether title's any good or not. As a fiduciary, they are guaranteeing that they have the authority to sign the instrument, but they are not guaranteeing the title of the property.
Power of attorney.
So that's a, I'm sorry?
Power of attorney included?
Power of attorney is a different issue. We'll talk about that in just a minute. But that's not, a power of attorney is not a type of deed.
But do they have authority to, they have a fiduciary to sign?
It's a little bit different, but okay. I'll distinguish that in just a minute. Okay. A person under a power of attorney does have a fiduciary duty to the principal, but normally does not sign a fiduciary deed. Normally it's a trustee, a guardian, a personal representative of the estate. A PR of an estate is a big one, and we're going to talk about estates in a minute. In other words, the person that's appointed by the court to handle an estate, he doesn't know whether the title is any good to the dead guy's property. But he does know he has the authority to sign the deed. That's the type of thing we're talking about here. The power of attorney is a good analogy, but it's not a type of deed, and it's not really a fiduciary, it doesn't normally give a fiduciary deed. We'll talk about that in just a minute. Those are the four types of deeds. Now we're going to talk about what's in a deed in general, but does anybody have any question about those and the distinctions between them?
So we're not going to focus on bargain and sale. We don't have to worry about that.
Bargain and sale, no. I don't even know what that is. I think it's like a quitclaim deed, you know, where there's no warranties, yeah. But we don't call it that for that. All right. Now,
sir, one more question. So getting a title insurance, would that make old deeds warranty deed?
Does title insurance guarantees that title is good, but it doesn't convert a special warranty deed into a general warranty deed. It's just kind of, we'll talk about that in a minute too, title insurance. It's kind of a different animal out there that guarantees to you for a premium that you have good title, no matter what kind of deed you have. If it turns out when title insurance you have a bad title, well, you sue the title insurance company. Not if you didn't buy title insurance, but if you do buy title insurance, your claim would be against the title insurance company. If you don't have title insurance, you're going to sue the person who sold it to you, but only based upon the warranties that they gave you, a full warranty or a special warranty. But a title insurance doesn't change the type of deed, but it may give you total protection, but it doesn't fix the fact that you only got a quitclaim deed. Title insurance can be issued on a quitclaim deed. If the person who signed it actually had good title. A quitclaim deed can be perfectly good, insurable, marketable, clean title. It's just that the seller who's given it doesn't guarantee it at all. But a title company might guarantee it for a premium.
Yeah. So what I understood is most sales will be special warranty deeds?
No. Most sales are general warranty deeds.
General warranty.
Most buyers insist that they get a general warranty deed. And 9 out of 10 sellers don't understand the difference and don't care. 9 out of 10 sellers aren't told that if you have a deep pocket, you probably don't want to sign a general warranty deed because you might get sued. They think they have good title. They probably do have good title. They probably don't care and don't understand the distinction. In 9 out of 10 deals, you'll see a warranty deed.
Differential between the general warranty and the special warranty?
A cost distinction?
Yeah.
As to whom?
Meaning, wouldn't everyone want to get a special warranty if they weren't sure?
Wouldn't everyone would want to get a full warranty deed, a warranty deed.
Okay.
The cost, though, if we're talking about the cost for a lawyer to prepare it, the cost is going to be the same. If we're talking about the cost of your deed, well, that's how much you pay the seller, which is the purchase price of the property. You're not going to pay less because they only offered to give a special warranty. The value of the property is the marketability of the property. You know, what is it rent for, what can I use it for, etc. It's pretty much a given. It is a given in an appraisal situation that the appraiser is going to assume you're getting good title. But you can get good title from a quitclaim deed. You can also get good title from a special warranty deed. You can get good titles from a warranty deed, or you can get bad title from any of the three. What this boils down to is, how good was the seller's title and what were the outstanding liens? That's what this is all about. And the fact that a guy with no title whatsoever gives you a warranty deed, that doesn't fix it. And still don't make it any good. If there are four mortgages on there and a guy gives you a warranty deed, well, they didn't pay him off, there's still four mortgages on there. You know, the issues as to whether you own it or not are much more based upon how good was your seller's title and what are the liens outstanding than they are based upon what kind of deed did you get. Okay, now here's what's in a deed. You don't need to learn the list of these things, you just need to understand in general what's going on in a deed. The first thing that the deed always does is it has words of conveyance. It's going to say something like the grantor grants and bargains and sells and conveys. You're going to see when we look at these deed forms, maybe about a dozen words that all mean the same exact damn thing. It's lawyers being redundant, saying the grantor hereby bargains, grants, sells, conveys, transfers, and on ad nauseum. The point is, it's going to have some of those words in there that say, I'm transferring the title to you. Those are words of conveyance. Secondly, you have to have a competent grantor. Well, that's kind of a given. Can't be 16 years old. Can't be adjudicated insane. For corporations and partnerships, there are special rules about who signs and stuff like that. We know that. But the point is, the grantor has to be competent to give a deed. There must be what's called an identifiable grantee. That's the buyer. What that means is, you have to deed to something that exists. You can't deed to a corporation that hasn't been formed yet. A lot of people think, okay, I'll have them deed it to XYZ Corp, and then next week when I get around to it, I'll file with the Secretary of State and I'll form XYZ Corp. That deed is void. XYZ Corp didn't exist on the date of that deed. You have to have something to convey it to. You can't convey title to a piece of property to the congregation of the First Baptist Church. But you can convey it to First Baptist Church, Inc. of Fort Lauderdale. That's a corporation. So it has to, the entity has to exist. It can't, you can't do a deed to all the people in Marlin Stadium. That's not an organization. That's not an entity. That's not an existing grantee. You got to have a, you know, but mom and dad, I mean, you can do a deed to Joe and Helen. That's fine. But if Joe's dead, you can't deed to Joe. Got to have a real person to deed to. All right. Fourth, you got to have an adequate legal description. We have a whole chapter coming up on legal descriptions. Simply, the deed has to adequately describe the property. You've heard already, and you'll hear some more, we don't do that by street address in Florida. We do that by legal description. We use a legal description to describe property, and we'll talk about where they come from, what they say, but got to have a good one. The deed has to be properly executed. This is a biggie. I do want you to understand the method in which a deed is executed, how and why. And the first thing that comes into play here is our same old nemesis that we've talked about twice before, the statute of frauds. Remember we talked about the statute of frauds for leases required that any lease over a year had to be in writing and had to have two witnesses. Okay? That's pretty similar to what the statute of frauds requires for deeds. The statute of frauds requires that a deed be in writing, but you know that. A deed is a written instrument. But it must be witnessed by two witnesses. That's what the statute of frauds requires in Florida. Signed by the grantor, whoever that is, and that's who signs it. We talked about early on, the seller, the grantor, the guy who's given the title, that's who signs it. Not the buyer, grantee, the one who's getting it, he doesn't sign it. But the grantor must sign it, and in Florida, must have two witnesses as required by the statute of frauds. And of course it must be in writing, But that's a given, because a deed is a written instrument. That's what the statute of frauds requires in Florida. Now, having two witnesses, the term for that is called attestation. Attestation, A-T-T-E-S-T-ation, attest. Two people sign next to the name of the grantor saying, we're witnesses, we attest, we confirm that this guy signed it. That's what the witnesses do. Now, in addition, in Florida, deeds are acknowledged. Acknowledged. Acknowledgement means notarized. Now, the text made a big deal out of that most states don't require that a deed be notarized to be valid. And that's sort of true in Florida. In Florida, we do not require that a deed be notarized to be valid, but we do require that a deed be notarized to be recorded. And we're going to talk about in another whole chapter recording. And frankly, if your deed can't be recorded, it isn't worth a crap. Because if you can't get it recorded in the public records, then you've accomplished nothing. You want your deed to be recorded. And in Florida, in order to be recorded, it must be notarized. The word for that is acknowledged. That whole section at the bottom of a deed where the notary says, I, the notary, hereby acknowledge, that's where the word comes from, acknowledge that Joe Blow, the seller, signed this deed in front of me. I watched him sign. And he acknowledged to me that he did it, and it was his free will, but most importantly, what that acknowledgement means in Florida is, I know that's who he was. That's why notaries ask you for driver's license and stuff like that. They are saying, I know that Joe Blow signed that deed, and I know that it was Joe Blow that signed that deed. And that's how we try to prevent fraud in Florida. That's how we try to prevent forgeries in Florida, is by notaries. That's why notaries ask for IDs. That's why when you go into a bank and say, will you notarize a certificate of title that's already been signed? The bank says, no. I want to watch it signed in front of me. And I want ID from the guy who's signing it. Because I'm swearing that I know that that was Joe Blow, and Joe Blow is who signed this document. But when you walk into a bank with a document already signed, they don't know who the hell signed it. You might have forged somebody's name out in the parking lot. That's why you wait to sign a deed until you get in the presence of the two witnesses who are going to witness your signatures and the notary. Now, don't get confused, and people often do. Two witnesses and a notary does not necessarily mean three people. Often the notary is one of the two witnesses. That's okay. You have to have two witnesses and one notary, but the notary can be one of the witnesses. Okay? But in Florida, to be valid, it has to be witnessed. To be recorded, it has to be acknowledged, which is notarized. And the test is signed by the grantor. Now, this is where we come to the question that Paul asked about before. What about a power of attorney? And a power of attorney is like we talked about in, and we talked about it a tiny bit when we talked about real estate brokerage. And a power of attorney, you have a principal and you have an agent, and it's agency. And it's just like we talked about, the law of agency is where a principal gives an agent the right to do something for him. In a power of attorney, the principal gives the agent, which is called the attorney in fact, in a power of attorney. The person being appointed is called the attorney in fact, but he's really an agent, giving him the authority to sign something, giving him the authority to do something, basically. But in our context here, we're talking about gives them the authority to sign a deed. Now, under a power of attorney, I'd be willing to sign a warranty deed for somebody because I, as the attorney in fact, am not guaranteeing the title. The person I'm signing for is guaranteeing the title. In that sense, if you gave me a power of attorney to sign a deed for you because you couldn't come to the closing, okay? I might sign a warranty deed for you. That means you guarantee the title. All I'm doing is being the signer. That's not the same as a fiduciary deed where I said, I'm a trustee or I'm a PR and I'm not warranting the title at all. Now, I want to talk about the limitations on a power of attorney and why a power of attorney is a nightmare, pain in the ass, for sure. And why people don't like them and why people won't accept them. And here's what you need to understand in Florida. And anyway, a power of attorney can be revoked simply by you saying, I revoke. You give me a power of attorney, all you got to do, and you can't get that document back. Understand this, a power of attorney is a piece of paper that she signs that authorizes me to go to a closing and sign stuff. But the morning of the closing, she changed her mind and decided she didn't want me to close. Something's wrong, I don't want to sell anymore, or whatever. All she has to do is say, I revoke. She doesn't have to tell me she revoked it. She doesn't have to tell the world she revoked it. She just says she revoked it. At that moment, it's revoked. I show up at the closing, sign the deed. Not only did she not tell me, didn't tell anybody, but she revoked it. The deed is void. The moment she revoked the power of attorney is no good. Or even worse, she got run over by a train that morning, and I go to the closing that afternoon. None of us knows she's dead, but the power of attorney is no good. Now, if you are at the closing and you're taking a deed from me under that power of attorney, how do you know it's still any good? You don't. You don't know whether or not she revoked it. You don't know whether or not she's alive. What you can do is get her on the phone. Have you revoked it? Nope. Sound like you're alive. You're still alive? Yep. Maybe the power of attorney is still good. Hopefully, before I put my name down there, she didn't change her mind after she hung up and say, I revoke it. The point is, power of attorneys are nightmares when they're used in closing because you don't know whether they're any good or not. And that's why an awful lot of people in closing say no, period. I don't care the seller's in Guatemala. We'll sign when the seller gets back from Guatemala. Or we'll send the documents by DHL to Guatemala and let the seller sign them there in front of the U.S. Embassy and DHL them back. We'll have them back in 2 days. But we're not taking a power of attorney. Banks will not let you use a power of attorney to sign a note mortgage. How do they know it's any good? They don't. So they just simply say no. I don't give a crap. I don't care if you got a power of attorney signed by George Bush. No. We're not taking it. There are too many risks inherent in it.
So
a lot of, pardon me?
Sorry, why are they still around?
I'm sorry,
why are power of attorney still
why is there such a thing?
Yeah.
Because some people will accept them. People, they use them for bank accounts. They're not bad for bank accounts. They'd be bad if you let somebody draw all the money out, but banks have their own forms of power of attorney, and right in those forms a bank use, they say, this power of attorney may not be revoked. Well, that protects him against revoking, but it still doesn't protect him if the guy didn't get run over by a car that day, and it's no good. Why are there powers of attorney? Because sometimes, for some things, they might work. And it might work very well if you wanted to call a seller in China and say, is the power of attorney still valid? Stay on the phone with me. He's signing the deed right now. Okay, is it still valid? All right, great. You're still alive and you haven't revoked it. That's good. Now we need about 10 witnesses to all say they heard that phone call and they know that that power of attorney was good. Or you can just say, that's a bunch of crap. Get your ass over here from China, and when you get here, and when you can sign a deed, we'll have a clue. Because they are nothing but problems. you can spend the rest of your life then trying to prove that the deed was valid. Why bother? Why don't you just say no? So my advice to you is, a lot of people say, oh, I can't come to the closing. Oh, great, give me a power of attorney, I'll take care of it. Maybe you'll get away with it. If you're dealing with anybody who has any savvy or any experience whatsoever, they're gonna say, bull, no way. It's, you're giving somebody else the authority to sign for you. But you can revoke it. And it can go away the moment you're dead. And one of the classic stupids that I've seen is people say, I'm dealing with an estate. Oh, you're in charge of the estate? Let me see your power of attorney. Now think about it. They're dead, right? So how the hell good is a power of attorney? But I can't tell you the number of times that people get away with it. They had a power of attorney from mom. And mom died, and now I'm trying to sell mom's property. And by God, 9 out of 10 times you can get away with it. Oh, you had a power of attorney? It was notarized? That's cool. Mom gave you the authority to sell our property? Okay, great, here's a sign of deed, here's the money. Obviously it's void. Mom's dead.
She's not here to contest it.
I'm sorry?
But the mom is not here to contest it anyway.
No, mom's not here to contest it, but one of the heirs might be. You know, somebody who inherited the property from mom. I'm her son, I inherited the property. But you're gonna sign a deed with a power of attorney for mom? I'll contest the hell out of it. When I come back to the house a month later and somebody's moved in, well, I have a deed from your dead mom under her power of attorney. Great, get your ass out of my house. It's my house. I inherited it.
They don't realize they need PR.
So, mom, no, mom's not going to contest it, that's for sure. But we're not really worried about mom anymore. We're worried about the validity of the document. That's not how you get a deed from an estate. We're going to talk about estates in a minute. The point is, a power of attorney is not a type of deed. It's simply a manner in which the grantor can sign, but it ain't a good one, and I don't recommend it. The last thing, a deed has to be delivered and has to be accepted. And I see now that it's 10 minutes to 2, so let's take our break until 2 minutes after 2, and we'll start again at 2:02. I'll see you then.
week, and I met everybody in the design studios, which is really cool. And then we looked at the satellite, like at some of their projects around the world. I guess like Google Maps is picking up some of it.
Taking to eat.
We talked about it. We talked about if I get to go, that I would take Arabic classes again, because you know, like that was what my degree was in, but I don't speak it anymore. But it's exciting, you know. And then we have another meeting set up for next week. Yeah, so it's good. He's like, they said they want to like sponsor me, to help me like get a job and like, you know, really find a position and teach next level. I'm excited. Thank you for asking. I appreciate it.
I actually bought donuts for everyone. Can't eat them all.
Oh, that's really nice.
Okay.
And they're like, you're telling me if you do anything you plan on, they're like, no, and it's a historic structure.
Oh, you can touch it.
You can't do anything to mess up the exterior. So you're right, they have a lot of power, but I mean, it's people who don't do their research that are.
Well, it's funny, by the other conversation, so the guy said, well, this one went well. Meaning like the other one, they get very intense. Because at the end of the conversation, we were able to negotiate what they wanted and what they needed. And then they felt released. I mean, when they felt that it was done, they felt released. But you can see the kitchen, their jobs, even though it's their job, it's not their division.
Yeah.
They're trying to find something just to comply with what they have to do.
Yeah.
So they have to stick to what they call to do. But it's not their staff, so they don't hire anyone. So that's what it's written, that's what we have to do. And they just keep saying that, that's what we do, that's what we have to do.
Yeah.
So it was good. It was my first experience.
Well, I'm glad that it happened, and it's just interesting learning about the process. That's exciting.
Yeah, it is. And we usually send someone, a lawyer, to do that, which is our lawyers.
Huh?
But the guy couldn't get anything. So I just.
So the lawyer was having trouble.
Yeah, because the approach was like, okay, so we don't think this is right, and then the argument for the planning was, well, that's the code, we have to comply. And then that was kind of their thing.
The lawyer doesn't have the creative.
Right. And then maybe they don't have the option that we have.
Yeah, exactly.
He was instructed to do what he was going to do that. And then in case, in our case, we can come up with something. And then, if they agree, so I went back to my boss and I said, this is what I did. You think it's good? And the guy said, yeah, it's good. So I said, okay.
That's what you gotta do, though.
Yes, yeah.
You know, and like those people will bring you in front of the mayor and the commission and stuff. You know, you want to have a completely professional.
I'm gonna have my first public hearing next week.
That's pretty cool. So it they're usually televised.
No,
so let me know when, and I'll tune in to public access to see what you see in action.
Well, the different is kind of it's gonna be one of those. This is the first one, this one, but my second one. So I'm gonna go with my architectural team, and then basically the staff already approved the change of use. So I just have to say yes, I agree with the staff.
And then they'll come up and say that they, you know, they recommend the change, and they agree to do and stuff, and then the committee will say most likely thumbs up.
Yeah, that's
so,
what I hope.
Yeah.
That's what I hope. But it's really fun because, you know, it's a different setting, and then you have those commissioners. You don't know what they're going to be asking.
No.
The problem is that I'm trying to change the use. It has a lake, and then it has a trailer part on the opposite side.
Okay.
So the only argument that I can see is they might see the action of business passing the lake. So I guess they can back in the food and water.
Okay.
So the people, you know, barbecuing, they don't want to see the cars, you know.
What kind of trailer park is that? Is it like a retirement community, or is it just
a
regular old trailer park?
Okay. It's right by Okeechobee and Congress. So
I know the trailer park, I know exactly where you're talking about. I don't
know what that's called. So this is Okeechobee, this is my location. Body of water, straight in park, kind of like
sort of by the outlet pump, right?
No.
But on the other side of the lake.
Before we pass 95. It's
okay.
In Congress, Church, PDQ, you know, there's a plaza, PDQ,
yeah.
Michael's.
Yeah, right there.
Okay, so Church is the first one. So we need to be here by the straight park by Church.
Okay.
That's the entrance. So you come to Church, this is Church Park, this is the water, this is my property, and this is Congress. So you can see the business from Church Park if you are facing west.
If it's going to help the local economy, I think that they're going to help you guys out more than the renters in the trailer park.
Yeah.
Because they're not huge stakeholders in the city, so.
And
they probably won't show up to the public hearing. So.
Yeah. That's what I hope. Nobody will come on. It's on Thursday at 9
each territory has their different rules. That's really cool that you're doing the process. I think that's really exciting.
Yeah, it is
so I'm happy for you.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, absolutely. You guys help me when you have any.
We were close to finishing the requirements of a deed, and we were deep into how a deed is signed, you know, with witnesses and notary and whether or not under power of attorney. The last requirement for a deed to be valid, and this is not a biggie, but it can happen, is the deed has to be delivered. In other words, seller basically has to hand the deed to the buyer and intend to transfer it. This happens like when old people sign a deed to their house and they put it in a drawer and they don't deliver it to their children or to whomever they intended to deed it to, and it gets found later after they're dead. The deed's not valid. It was never delivered. That's all. A requirement is that a deed be delivered in order to be valid. So those are pretty much the basics of what it takes to be a valid deed. Frankly, we're going to look at some deed forms. And if you follow the deed form and do what it tells you to do, you're going to knock off most of these things. You need competent parties, of course, and you have to intend for the deed to happen. But those things normally will take care of themselves, too. The last concept that I want to talk about that relates to deeds, and we're going to look at some deeds, is deed restrictions. Understand that in a deed, a seller, a grantor, the person who is deeding property, can put restrictions, can put conditions right in the deed, and they have to be followed. Usually it's things like, don't use this property as a filling station. And that's enforceable. Now, I want to distinguish how that relates to a concept we talked about earlier in Chapter 4. In Chapter 4, we talked about something called a defeasible fee. Or when we used that Birch State Park example, yeah, where we said that property can revert back and the deed fails. Those were the types of conditions in a deed that render the conveyance a defeasible fee. What that means is a fee simple was given but can be unfeased to come back, defeased. These are not what we're talking about here. There are two kinds of conditions you can put in deeds. Well, there was the type we talked about in Chapter 4 where title fails and title actually comes back.
Subject to a condition.
I'm sorry?
Subject to a condition.
You might use, those could be the words. I mean, there are 100 words you could use. Subject to it never being used for a filling station. I mean, you can say that. You can use that upon the condition, whatever. We're not talking about the buzzwords that you use. We're talking about the type of restriction that it is. Certain types of restrictions, by their nature, the way they're written, provide that title will fail and will come back. That's not what we're talking about here. We're now talking about a valid deed where title doesn't come back, but the seller puts restrictions in there and says, but the property can never be used for a filling station. what that, in those cases, and we're going to talk about why you might do something like that, in those cases, the restriction can be enforced by a court action, but the title's not coming back. The title has been conveyed. And you might say, well, why would a seller want to do something like this? Why would a seller want to put a condition in a deed? Well, maybe he lives next door. And maybe he doesn't want a filling station next door. Maybe he wants, maybe there's nothing built yet next door and he wants certain setbacks. Often it's when a seller has adjoining property and the seller's trying to restrict the adjoining property, what happens on it? He might want to put in there so long as there's never a garbage dump, if you're next door. So long as there's never a any type of offensive activity that you don't want to happen. The point is, the remedy is not going to be the title comes back. The remedy is you can go to court and enforce a restriction. This is private zoning. This is a seller imposing conditions upon what you can do with a piece of property, just like zoning does, but imposed by a seller. And that's a deed restriction. In our first case, it was a deed with conditions. This is a deed restriction, a restriction contained in a deed. Property can only be used for the following purpose. A big example was in Coral Springs. Westinghouse, which is Coral Ridge Properties, which is Westinghouse, that developed Coral Springs, they thought filling stations were ugly. And they didn't want filling stations on corners, and they didn't like signs out there that said $2.25, etc. So just about every deed of every corner in Coral Springs has a restriction put in there by the developer saying no filling stations. Period. You can't do it. If you do, the developer who put the restriction in there can come in and enforce it and can make you tear the filling station down. And think about how that restricts you in the future. So you buy it as an investment piece of property and you want to sell it again, even four or five conveyances down the road. You're not selling it to Shell Oil Company. You're not selling it to some local filling station operator because the condition's in the deed and they know that the person who placed the condition can enforce it. Nor are you going to be able to go to a bank and borrow money to build a filling station or a convenience store. Restriction, that's an example, but there are any number. You know, no factories next door, no walls next door, no whatever. That's a deed restriction. Deeds which convey property can contain restrictions for which the property can be used.
And then I'm assuming that when you do the title search, those restrictions are
you look right
ready.
There in your face. Okay. There it is. You look at the deed and there it is. That's why you have to read every word that's in a deed. A lot of people say, oh, there's a deed. You got to read the things. They may contain a restriction. And it's enforceable until it goes away, and we'll talk about the goes away in a minute. The deeds, a restriction says you can't do something. You can also put affirmative covenants in a deed. You can say something you have to do. And that's enforceable. So long as you build a wall within the next year, you're required to build a wall. Seller doesn't want to look at what you're going to build. Puts a condition in a deed so that you can build a wall later. But the point is, it's a condition in a deed, and it is an affirmative condition that requires you to do something. When the conditions where you have to become a member of a homeowner association and pay dues and maintenance assessments, those are affirmative covenants. Those are things you have to do. They're not prohibitions, like you can't put an American flag in your window or aluminum foil on your window. Those are restrictions. But you have to join an association and pay dues and pay maintenance assessments. Those are affirmative covenants. Those are contained in deeds. Now, sometimes when you develop a whole subdivision and maybe create a homeowner association and a guard gate and maintenance and provisions on painting your houses and paying assessments and belonging to the swimming pool and all of the crud that you do in these planned unit developments, developers record a document that contains all of this crud in one. And it's called a declaration, just like our declaration of condominiums. Remember declaration, I hereby declare that this is a condominium that a developer signs? Well, here, the The person that owns the property says, I'm the owner of the property, and I declare that in all subsequent conveyances of the property, the property use and whatever is regulated by the following declaration of restrictions. Now, we call these, normally they're called a declaration of restrictions. Sometimes they may be called a declaration of covenants, a declaration of conditions. The text calls them conditions, covenants, restrictions, CC&Rs. But the point is, they're in a separate document called a declaration. And here's what you put in the deed. You don't then have to put 7 pages of crud in the deed of you may not do this, you may do, must do that. You just say, this deed is subject to all matters set forth in the recorded declaration of restrictions, and you set forth the recording reference of that declaration. That's just as valid as if the deed had all 7 pages of yeses and noes in it, of what you can't do and what you must do. And that's a declaration. In most planned unit developments, that's how they're done. Each, you can put in every deed 7 pages of restrictions if you want to, or you can put in each deed simply, you go record all those things one time, and you just say, subject to all matters set forth in the declaration recorded at such as a book of business. But those are deed restrictions. Those are restrictions on the title that were created by putting them in a deed at some point. And they're on there forever now. Forever and ever and ever. Until one of two things happens. Either they're released, and that would be Westinghouse or Coral Springs coming back and saying, okay, we're just kidding. You can have filling stations now. We don't care anymore. We release that restriction. Or the developer who created that whole declaration of restrictions saying they're canceled. Often they contain provisions that have their own expiration. Often a declaration of restrictions will say something like, this declaration shall remain in effect for 30 years from the day it's recorded, unless an amendment is recorded to extend its term or something, and then it'll go away at 30 years, or 50 years, or 100 years, or whatever they put in there. That's how they can go away too, is by an expiration date built in. Lastly, we have something in Florida called MRTA that is complicated. MRTA, it's the Marketable Record Title Act. And what it basically does is tries to get rid of stale restrictions. What this is all about is, if for 30 years a restriction is never again mentioned in the records, it goes away. Okay? But it's much more technical than that. That's a way oversimplification. But it can do away with old restrictions that nobody cares about anymore. We'll see restrictions in deeds that say, back in the 30s, that say, no household servants may ever live in this property. Well, not only was that abolished by the Supreme Court, but separately, if it's never mentioned again for 30 years, our statute says it goes away. So restrictions are valid. They are valid until they're released, or until they expire, or until MRTA gets rid of them, but that's rare and unlikely. Just be aware of the concept that deeds can contain restrictions and they're enforceable. And they're enforceable by law simply by going into court and saying, Your Honor, make them do it. Make them quit doing this. Said no, or Your Honor, make him do this because the deed said he had to. Now, let's look at some deeds. And I'd like to show you now the most valuable real estate tool that I think you'll find in the public records anywhere. And it's the property appraiser's website. So if you'll take a look at those website, property appraiser website printouts that I sent you, and then the deeds to go with them. I'd like to show you how the property appraiser website works. And I'd like to tell you that what we talked about before of their three really important things to get right in a sales contract, two of the three of them come from right here. So this is where you go to find them when you're preparing a sales contract on a piece of property that you know nothing about. The three things I told you had to get right in a sales contract were the names of the parties, and the legal description, and the signatures. Well, the first two are come from right here. The names of the parties, and the legal description. And the third one is you making sure you get the right people to sign it, and if it's an entity, you go to sunbiz.org to find out who has a right to sign for that entity and get the right signatures. So let's look at the property appraiser's website. This one was printed out, as you'll see, this page that I sent you as an example in 2014, the date in the bottom right, 11/13/14. That's the date this was printed out. That's why it has a picture of Lori Parrish. She is no longer the property appraiser. We got a new property appraiser in Broward named Marty Hiar. He was the chairman of the county commission. So now when you look at this page, his picture is there. But the point is, the property appraiser is the person that we talked about that when you set real estate taxes, remember, they set the value of your property. It gets multiplied times the millage, and then that's what creates your taxes. Well, this is the website as to every piece of property where the property appraiser is setting the value of that piece of property for tax purposes. But it is a wealth of information. And the way you get to a piece of property, you go to the property appraiser's website. As you'll see in the lower left, it's bcpa.net for Broward. There's one just like it for Palm Beach, there's one just like it for Dade and every other county. The property appraisers have websites. And you go to their website, bcpa.net for Broward. You find some choices there, and the choice that you want to choose is property search. You'll click on the tab called property search. And then it asks you, how would you like to search? Would you like to search based on the owner's name? Or would you like to search based on the street address? And it gives you some other choices too. Those are the two that you're going to use. And in most cases here, let's say you're looking at a piece of property that you want to buy, you're probably going to know the street address. So you're going to plug in the street address. And that's based on the street address that you plug in, this is the page that's going to come up. So let's look at this one and see what do we learn from it. Let's say we're looking at a piece of property in downtown Fort Lauderdale that right now is vacant. It's at the northeast corner of 3rd Avenue and 3rd Street. And it just happens to be the address is 300 Northeast 3rd Avenue. So let's say you plugged in this prime piece of downtown real estate that's vacant at 3rd and 3rd, and you plugged in 300 Northeast 3rd Avenue, Fort Lauderdale. This is the page you'll get. And here's what it'll tell you. The site address is it. That's what you plugged in. To the right of that is the ID number. That's the property appraiser's folio number. That's just their account number, so to speak. Below it, it tells you who the owner is. Now that pretty much, assuming they've got it correct, but you're going to want to look a little deeper, that's pretty much the name of your seller that you're going to want to put in a sales contract. They're telling you who the record owner of the property is. There's your seller when you get a sales contract. There's who you want signing your sales contract. They told you this one is owned by the City of Fort Lauderdale Employees Retirement Fund. Okay? The mailing address is where the tax bill is mailed every year. If you can't find this person and want to know where to go find the owner, that's where you find it. Abbreviated legal description. That's a not-so-good legal description. It's a better-than-nothing legal description. But it's usually written in hieroglyphics that most people can't translate very well. We can do better, and I'm going to show you how we do better, based upon this same search. But in worst case, if you got nothing else, you use that as a legal description. The street address was at the top of the page, the site address, and this is an abbreviated legal description. Now here's what they tell you. They tell you property assessment values. These are the assessed values of this property based upon which the taxes are going to be generated. So looking at this one, kind of interesting, look at 2014 for a minute. 2014, in the middle, they told you the just value of this property was $423,000, $960,000. You're going to see what a joke that is in a minute. But the point is, In 2014, that was the market value of the property according to the property appraiser, based upon which taxes are going to be based, and their taxes were $12,398 over on the right. And they told you that that was based upon land valuation at $213,960 and building valuation at $210,000. When you look up at 2015, you see there's no building there. What does that tell you? They knocked the building down. The owner knocked down the building. Property appraiser doesn't get to tax the building anymore. He only gets to tax the land. So for that year, the tax value was $213,000 because there's only the land, no more building. Now, all the exemptions that we talked about, exemptions for the two different homestead exemptions, and I think I told you there was a list of another dozen or so. Well, they're all listed down here, whether you have them or not. Widows, disabled, senior, that's all this crud in the middle. We don't care about that. What we care a lot about is the section called sales history.
Right.
Because it's going to do two things for us. It's going to tell you the price of the property over the last four or five recent sales and the dates. And it's going to give you a recording reference to the deed so you can go find the deed that sale, that was the deed that actually created that sale. And even better, you see these recording references? These were books and pages. You see where it says book and page or CIN?
Yeah.
Well, until the year 2015, everything had a book and page. In the year 2015, we abolished that and started naming instruments CIN, which means clerk's instrument number. It's no big, you don't care. The point is, this is how you find the instrument. Well, here's the beauty of this. You can click on that book and page right there, and that deed will pop up in front of you, and you can look at it. And that's what we're going to do. We're going to look at these deeds. Over to the right, it tells you the land calculations. They're telling you how many square feet they thought the property was. But they use these funky factors that are kind of strange, but they're telling you how they came up with their price. Was that they thought that there were 6,113 square feet of land at $35 a foot, and that's how they came up with $213,000 as the value of the land. But adjusted building square footage, when there is a building, they'll give you the square footage of the building, and you can click on that, and you'll see sketches of the building. A lot of information at this website. Now, let's use the one, though, that I told you is of so much value, which is the sales history, because this is going to lead us to the deeds, and that's going to show you deeds, and that's going to show us different kinds of deeds that we're going to talk about, and each of these different types we've seen. But it gives you all the information in the world you could ever want about a piece of property by looking at these deeds. Let's start with the one on the bottom, because they go from at the top, newest, to oldest on the bottom. The very oldest one on the bottom, there's no date there, but I'm going to tell you that date was 1980, but that's before they posted stuff onto the computer. And the type of deed, you can probably figure out some of these abbreviations. What do you think an SW is? Probably a special warranty deed, right? What do you think a QC is at the top? That's probably a quitclaim deed, right? So they're telling you the type of deed it was, and we're going to go look at these. Well, this first one in 1980 happened to be a warranty deed, and we're going to look at it. And we're going to look at it by we would click on that 9149-476. That means official records book page 9149-476, if you ever wanted to go find it. You click on that. And what's going to pop up in front of you is the next page that I sent you. That's a deed. If you look over on the right-hand margin, three quarters of the way down, see, official records book 9149, page 476. That's that recording reference on that deed we looked at. So bingo, we got the right deed here. That's the deed they were telling us about. Now let's look at the deed for a minute. First of all, you're probably going to guess this is a warranty deed because it tells you that three different ways. The language begins out, this warranty deed, that's pretty helpful. Up in the very upper left, when you pull the form out of the form drawer, back in the 1980s when we prepared deeds, you had form drawers of all the different forms. Well, this was a form for a corporation to a corporation warranty deed. So some secretary pulled the right form out of the right drawer and typed in the blanks, and that's how we did deeds in those days. Up on the right, this was a Ramco form number, 33 and a half or something. The point is, it was a form for a warranty deed from a corporation to a corporation, and that's what it is. It's a warranty deed. So you'll see, this is a deed made in 1980 between a corporation, Realty Leasing Corporation in Georgia, whose address is so-and-so, on the left-hand margin, hereinafter called the grantor. Remember, the grantor is the seller. So that was the grantor. Two, Venture One Inc., a Georgia corporation, corporation existing, addressed, hereinafter called the grantee. So now we know who was the grantor and who was the grantee in this deed. And looking down after the witnesses, second line near the end, does hereby grant, bargain, sell, remise, release, convey, and confirm unto the grantee. Those are those words of conveyance we talked about in every deed. And what are they conveying? They're conveying this land in this legal description. We're not going to focus on legal descriptions now, but here's a bunch of lots, and that's what they convey. Lots of lots here in this deed. Continue on down after the typed in legal description, two more pre-printed paragraphs, and go to the one called and. And this deed says, and grantor hereby covenants with the grantee that the grantor is lawfully seized of the land in fee simple, that it has good and lawful authority to sell and convey the land, and here's the magic words we talked about, and it hereby fully warrants the title to the land and will defend the same against the lawful claims of all persons whomsoever. Remember, we said those are the magic words you'll find in every warranty deed. So now you've seen three different ways to know for sure that this was a warranty deed, because it says it twice at the top, and it's got warranty deed words in there, fully warned against the claims of all persons whomsoever. And this was a deed by a corporation. So you see it gets signed by the president, L. Allen Morris. It got signed by the assistant secretary, who slapped a corporate seal on there. It got two witnesses. You remember we said every deed has to have two witnesses. There they are, signed, sealed, and delivered in the presence of. These are the two witnesses. And then we had an acknowledgement at the bottom. This is where it gets notarized. This is a notary in Dade County, Florida, saying, I hereby certify that personally appear before me a person authorized to take acknowledgments at the end of the line. See, this is an acknowledgement. That Alan Morris and Dean, Corporal, they personally appeared before me, they acknowledged they signed the deed. So as a notary, the notary slapped her seal on there and signed it. And we now have a notarized warranty deed that can be recorded, and did get recorded at the book and page. This is what a warranty deed looks like. Okay? All right. Let's go back to the search for a minute. The next deed, believe it or not, was 23 years later. In September 22nd of 2003, next deed is a special warranty deed. The property appraisers posted the price on that one was $2,195,000. And it gives you the book and page. You click on the book and page, and you're going to come up with the next deed, which is the next deed that I sent you. Now, the recording format's a little different. This time you find that official record book and page up above that matches up. So, yep, I got the right document. And they said it was a SW, and by God, that's how this one starts up. This special warranty deed. Looks like this is going to be a special warranty deed. So the corporation who got the deed in the last deed is now going to sell. So it's changed its name, it's a successor by merger to a, but it's the same corporation. Hereinafter called the grantee to Los Olas Properties, Inc., a Florida corporation. That's who bought it. So this deed conveyed the property from all those Georgia corporations to a Florida corporation named Los Olas Properties, Inc. Same kind of buzzword language in the middle, witnesseth. Third line, hereby grants, bargains, sells, aliens, remises, conveys, all that same language crud. The legal description of the lots. At the bottom of the page, same kind of talk. And grantor hereby covenants with the grantee, is lawfully seized, has good and lawful authority to sell. The grantor will warrant the title and will defend the same against the lawful persons, lawful claims of all persons claiming by, through, or under the grantor, but no others. What did this corporation guarantee? This corporation guaranteed the title for the 23 years that it owned the property. But that's it. says, before that, don't talk to me. I'm guaranteeing good title for the 23 years that I owned it. That's a special warranty deed. Next page is just basic signature block of corporations. You'll see, interestingly here, people might wonder, well, wow, this looks like a lot of witnesses here. Well, a couple things. We changed the law that required witnesses to print their name underneath their signatures, so that looks like they're more witnesses than they are. Each witness is there with a signature with a printed name underneath. We kind of figured out years later it didn't do any good. The purpose of having witnesses is so you can find somebody to testify they saw the deed sign. Well, if we couldn't read their writing, we couldn't find them very well. So this was supposed to help. They print their names now, but I can't read those either. But interestingly, notice there are two sets of witnesses. Two sets of witnesses. And here's why. W. Allen Morris, Vice President, he signed the deed in Miami. And here's his two witnesses. But the next person, James F. Bell Jr., another Vice President, they apparently had corporate rules that they needed two Vice Presidents. That's cool. You can have a dozen. You got to have one. They had two. Well, this guy signed in Decatur, Georgia, DeKalb County, Georgia. So he probably didn't have the same two witnesses, and they got different notaries because they signed separately, they had separate witnesses, and they had separate notaries. That's a special warranty deed. Let's look back at the property appraiser search and see what happened next. In 2001 is a CET. That's a real ugly thing. That's a certificate of title. Let's go look at that. It's one page document called Certificate of Title, and what this means that Los Olas Properties, Inc., that bought the property we saw in 2003, must have had a mortgage with Seacoast National Bank and didn't pay the mortgage back. And Seacoast National Bank foreclosed the mortgage. The court had a foreclosure sale, and at the end of the foreclosure sale, the buyer is going to get title of the property with this document. This is the document then where the court gives title to the buyer at the foreclosure sale. So here, the clerk of the court, Howard Foreman, signs this and says that the property on the attached page, which is the legal description, was sold to TC Property Venture LLC down at the bottom there. So this document is a transfer of the title by the court to the buyer at the foreclosure auction. We're going to talk about that in our last class. We're going to talk at length about foreclosures, auctions, how they happen. Well, this is one of them. So this is a document. Now you can see the clerk posted that at $100 because that's all that was bid at the sale. Because people don't bid real money at sales. But this is a transfer of title. So title now belongs to TC Property Venture LLC. Next instrument is a month later in 2011, another special warranty deed. You're then going to see that TC Property Venture in the next document, which says special warranty deed, and we know it's an SW because the property appraiser told us, sold this property for $3.5 million. So in this deed, TC Property Venture sold the property to the Board of Trustees of the City of Fort Lauderdale General Employees Retirement System. And remember, that's who we saw on the clerk's website, was who the current owner was. So that's who bought the property for $3.5 million. A special warranty deed, legal description, same special warranty language we looked at down below. We'll defend the same against the lawful claims of all persons claiming by, through, and under the grantor, but not otherwise. That's the special warranty. This is signed by TC Property Venture, which interestingly, its manager is the bank, the same Seacoast Bank who foreclosed it. So this deed transferred the property for $3.5 million. A day later, on December 1st, there's recorded a quitclaim deed, if you'll look back at the property appraiser search, a QC. That's the next instrument. Somebody decided it was a good idea to go see Los Olas Properties, Inc., who had the property foreclosed and taken away from them. And just in case they still had any rights, they said, Los Olas Properties, how would you like to sign a quitclaim deed just to help clean up any claims? Los Olas Properties, being good guys, said, sure, we've lost the property in the foreclosure. We'd be glad to sign a quitclaim deed free. It'd be nice to help out the city. We could earn some brownie points there. We could also help out the bank that foreclosed against us. So let's be good guys. Sure, we'll sign a quitclaim deed. So look what the quitclaim deed does. Now, Los Olas Properties, Inc., who, as you know, paid $2,195,000 for the property, but had it foreclosed and taken away from them, now gives a deed to the same board of trustees of the city. What it says it does in this language in the middle here, does hereby remise, release, convey, and quit claim unto the grantee all the right title, interest, and claim the grantor has in the following property. Usually it says, if any, because remember, in a quit claim deed, you're not necessarily conveying anything. So it conveys the same property. And you'll notice down at the bottom, there are no warranties whatsoever. There's none of this hereby warrant, specially warrant, fully warrant the claims against anybody. There are no warranties at all, because this is a quit claim deed. So Los Olas Properties gives a quit claim deed to the city also, just to help clean up any interest that Los Olas Properties may still have. Now, what you've seen here is in each of these cases, you've seen different kinds of deeds, but when we talked about going to look at things, if you were preparing a sales contract, the place to get the name of the seller correctly is look at the deed. Look at the last deed. The most current deed in each of these cases is to the Board of Trustees of the City of Fort Lauderdale's General Employees Retirement System. If you want to buy this piece of property, who are you going to put on the sales contract as a seller? That name right off of the deed. And what are you going to use as a legal description? You're going to use the legal description from these deeds. Remember the property appraiser had an abbreviated one? Well, a better one is in these deeds prepared by lawyers or by surveyors, and we'll talk about that in a minute, but use the legal description out of the deed. So there's your seller, there's your legal description, and all you gotta do is get the signatures right and you've got a valid binding contract. Now we're gonna go one step more because this gets even more interesting. So we know that in 2000, you know, we're looking at the history here, we're trying to figure out what's happened with this piece of property. We know that in 2011, that the city of Fort Lauderdale bought this piece of property for its employees' retirement fund as an investment for $3.5 million. I ran another search. That's the other search I sent you. I apologize for the legibility of it. It's just how it came out. It looks great when you look on the property appraiser's website. When you try to print it, it got fuzzy. But let me tell you what it says. This is another search in the upper right-hand corner of this one. This is run a year later, no, 2 years later, in November of 2016. Now you see, we got a different owner. The name of the property owner now is 303rd and 4th LLC. And if we look down at the history, look at the history now. On 9-3-2015, this property was sold for $8,400,000.